Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the MedTrade, and of course, welcome to Material Experience here next door. This is the show of materia which we have now every year. We especially collected materials that are interesting for the yachting industry, for the maritime industry. It should be lightweight, of course. It should be fire resistant for some weather. But it's also about the interior. It should be about luxurious and nice new stuff. First, I'm going to explain something about Materia, as far as you don't know what it is. Materia is an international global network. So what we do is always try to stimulate the use of innovative materials in the built environment. So we are connecting the creative professionals like designers, like architects, engineers, with the industry who makes these materials. We collect new materials, innovative materials all over the world. It can be from architecture, about design, about sports, about fashion, about packaging industry, about mobility sector. So we are inspired by a lot of sectors, and we publish them on the website. So the connection between the creative professional and the industry is done by the website. For instance, these materials are accessible for free, and you have to subscribe, so we know who is looking. And you see here a top, I call it the VIP list, of our 100,000 international members. And you see the diversity of it. It's our architects, it's designers, but it's also from Apple, BMW, and also Wally, the famous yacht designer, also FedChip, and also the Muppet Studio. You know, everybody who's creative is looking on our website and is inspired by the materials that we publish. From all these materials, we ask for samples. You can see them over here. And we are invited all over the world by different fairs to create a theme-related exhibition, whether it's about carpets, about lightweight materials, or bio-based materials, or textiles. We are able to create this exhibition for fairs and events to attract the target group. And you can see here a small amount of the places where we're going to. So it is really very global. And the fun thing is, of course, that we also can spot new materials over there. So we get inspired by these locations too. Material Experience, the big one is our own fair. At the end of January, it will be in Rotterdam. 250 new materials, two halls stuck with all the new innovation regarding materials. And in smaller versions, like here, we are showing our own materials and our partners. You can see four of our partners showing their materials too. We publish books, so the last book, Material Discovery, is also available here at the site. And we organize exhibitions and seminars and lectures, and we invite all interesting people in seminars. So what I'm going to talk about now is we are always into the techno transfer between the variety of sectors. And the architecture world and the maritime world is a very interesting one. The yachting club is a little bit closed, actually. So here's some inspiration, of course, a very modern architecture from Le Corbusier, but now the most modern yacht, of course, for Steve Jobs, the Venus, done by Philip Stark. You can see a difference in the design of the yachting industry in general. The Venus has been especially designed to show as less details and stuff as possible. So on the right, you can see this big old-fashioned kind of yacht filled with all kind of fenders and things and electronics. And Venus has been designed on an Apple way, of course. The less the better it is. So you can see a kind of a shifting in the yacht. So this is Wally, done by Wally. Totally different appearance than what we are used to in the yachting industry. And also the new materials, more lightweight. You can see the sail, totally different materials that we are used to. So a little bit about sustainability. There has been a really interesting seminar on Monday evening, or Monday in general, about recycling the yachts. It's a huge problem, especially in the Netherlands. All those yachts made of GRPs cannot be recycled. People who have the boats are just let it sink because it costs money to get it recycled. Recycling is very difficult. In the building industry, you have, of course, the same problem. How do you deal with sustainability? If you're looking here at the way how we use materials in the past hundreds of years, you can see that, of course, we started with wood and natural materials because that was available. And then we had some stone and some Iron Age, and then Industrial Revolution started. You can see this on the orange curve. So all the natural materials were replaced by iron, then concrete, aluminum and metals and plastic. So all the natural materials, the bio-based materials, were replaced by mineral materials which are not biodegradable. You cannot just throw glass and metal in just in nature, and it's not eaten by microorganisms, while natural materials do have that feature. And on this, the yellow curve, you can see actually the how many minerals versus the natural materials there are, and you can see also that in the few hundred years we have 8 times more minerals than natural materials. So there's a shift going on. So what can we do? We can say, okay, we go back, of course, into using bio-based materials, or you can have a very interesting and good logistic to recycle all the mineral materials, like the plastics and the glass and the concrete. I'm going to talk about increasing the properties and the quality of natural materials, because wood and natural materials, all fun, very good, but it rots. And rotting is exactly being eaten by a microorganism. And it cannot be bended, it cannot be outside, it's not fire resistant, it cannot... So, but our intelligence is able to increase these properties. So we can make wood bendable, like a ducta wood. With CNC milling, you make a configuration where this material can be bended very easily. Arboform is liquid wood. It has it's not really wood, it's cellulose, which is available because the newspaper industry is, of course, a very good recycling industry, but the waste that's coming from washing the old newspapers, this waste contains a lot of cellulose too, and then they make this material out of it. So it's cellulose, but it's coming from the waste industry. Dendrolite, it's making lightweight wood, because wood is, a lot of the material in wood is not used. It's just being there, but it's not really used. So if you, again, with CNC milling, are taking away the materials, you can make it half as light or heavy as normal wood, but you are able to have the same strength. Akoya is modified wood. It's because if you are looking for what's happening with wood, why does it rot? Why do these microorganisms like wood that much? It's because in the molecule structure, the OH connection is in the cellulose is what they like best. So this is why they eat it. So if you put wood into an acid or into vinegar, then this OH connection is replaced by a vinegar or an acid. It is a little bit chemical talk, but you are changing something in the molecule, and then the microorganisms do not recognize it, they don't like it, they say, oh, I'm not going to eat this. And so with just some acid or vinegar and water, you can change the quality of normal soft wood, which is growing just here in Europe. We don't have to take it from Brazil anymore. You have the same properties. It's just quality number A. You are it's possible to use it outside, on your deck, on your facade, just like hardwood. It's a very sustainable way to upgrade the quality of materials. Pre-beam, how can we make wood flexible? Well, to combine it with a flexible honeycomb of aluminum. You can also bend wood if you treat it in a wide way. You make it soft, you make it in a special liquid. Luminoso is a transparent wood. So the transparency is made by adding glass fibers to the wood. So the layers of, you have a layer of wood, you have a layer of glass fiber, textile, and of course glass fiber is emitting the transparency and light, so this is how you are able to make the transparent wood. We can use cork. Cork is a very interesting material. It used to, actually Portugal is stuffed with cork trees, and the cork is coming from the cork tree, and this industry has a big problem because 100,000 of people are depending on this industry. They used to make the cork for the glass bottles for the wine industry, but since the wine industry is using screws and plastic corks, this industry has a problem. So the biggest organization, Amorim, has tried to get designers and architects interested to use this material in furniture, in buildings, and to upgrade the material itself. It's as a granulate, you can press it in all kinds of forms. It's fantastic material. It's fire resistant. It's elastic. It's totally biodegradable. And if you use it treat it with pressure and with heat and with steam, or you put it in a microwave, it behaves like popcorn. So it will become twice its volume. It's double. It's more lightweight. It's becoming black, it smells a little bit, but you can use it perfectly as an insulation material for your building or for your boat, not only for the heat insulation, but also for the trillingen, the movement of, for instance, the motors of a yacht. Decking, this is an interesting picture because normally the decks are always made of teak. And then they say, okay, it's a lot of maintenance and it costs a lot of money, and you can hear it's not really acoustic, so let's use cork. But then you say, okay, why are those seams still there? They have no function at all. Because, of course, the seams were rubber and black rubber to connect the small strips of teak. But this, you can just cover this whole deck with just one tapestry, one carpet made of cork. So it's totally useless to have the seam only for aesthetic value and to have this idea of, this is how a deck should look like. So I'm waiting for the first yacht or for the first boat that's covered just in cork without those idiot seams. Bamboo, of course, very biodegradable material. It's growing very fast. It can be a meter in a few days. So it's really available. It's only available in China and in Asia. That's a little bit of, that's not so good because we have to transport it to here. And it's not really very durable. It rots very, it has classification 5, so it rots very easily. But again, you can use it and treat it with technique to make it more durable, more sustainable, to make it fire resistant, to make it more possible to use outside. So you can press it. There is bamboo which you can use on your terrace, you can use on your facade, you can use window screens of it. It's a very heavy material and all done by really sustainable techniques. You can use paper to design. Of course, it's all cellulose, it's coming from trees, it's coming from newspapers. Shigeru Ban, a very famous Japanese architect, is building houses and shelters for the homeless in Japan because it's very lightweight. Everybody has paper, it's really good available. The only problem is it cannot handle water very much, it's not fire resistant, so you have to treat it again to make it to upgrade it. And another thing is, it's coming from the packaging industry, and they are not really used to think out of the box to use this cardboard into other industries. But it's very lightweight, and actually it's a good material. So Philip Jonker is a designer who wanted to make a boat out of cardboard. So he's totally made, he's building now the Fury. A few years ago, he had the idea, I'm going to make a boat. He bought the drawing from a very old kind of boat, and it is honeycomb cardboard, and he totally made the structure. And finally, you can see it's just like a comic drawing boat, like a Berend Botje. Like a beer and butcher boat, but it's totally made out of cardboard. The structure, the honeycomb is very strong, it's very lightweight. Of course, it has to be treated against the water, and And he did this with the Megapore coating. It's a polyurethane coating. But he traveled with this from the Netherlands to London. If you go to YouTube, it's a fantastic movie. It was too long to show it here, but it's a fantastic movie, how he's making this boat, how he's going to sail from Netherlands to London. As you see this little cardboard thing just jumping up and down in the sea. It's really very interesting. So you are able to make a yacht or a boat made of cardboard. Megapore coating on it. He did this with, he's now busy also with making houses of cardboard. So really interesting research for how can you use this very cheap, normal material into a very good, interesting material product. What's going on in the yachting industry, in the architectural and design industry, is using new sources of materials. Because we have to use more renewable materials, not only wood and cork and bamboo, but we can also use garbage. So the leftovers from the nuts industry, for instance, or coffee. What do you think about the coffee industry? A lot of designers now are busy with making kind of a composite of coffee, because 500, only in Europe, 500 million people are drinking 5 kilo coffee a year. Only in Europe, not talking about America. And the only thing that we are doing with coffee is taking the flavor. We are not making anything. You just throw the material, the stuff, we just throw it away. So a lot of designers are busy now of using the coffee ground or the leftovers from coffee into new composites and new materials. Other examples, newspaper wood. It's from a Dutch design company, Five it's called, and they invented this years ago, and it was everybody wanted to have it. It's made out for old newspaper. If you just roll them up and you press them and you're using water-based glue, then you can make a tree. And from this tree, they are cutting panels of this newspaper tree. And it's a fantastic material. You can see a little bit the color of the ink. But it takes a lot of time. I think it's in this case, it took 5 years to develop this material and to test it. Is it before you can take it on the market? Developing new materials is a very difficult, difficult way of innovation. It's not just, you cannot use it right away. Husk, for instance, is a material that's made of the shells of macadamia nuts. In New Zealand, they are made there. And all the nuts that we are eating here, instead of walnuts, because they grow here, but all the, just imagine all the nuts you eat, they don't have shells here. All the shells are left over in Asia. So in Asia, they have a huge amount of nut shells, whether it's from a macadamia nut or whatever nuts they have. And they can be grounded, and you can add a bio-based resin or another resin to it, and you can make fantastic composite, and you can make fantastic stuff. So Duralmond is made from the shells of the almond nut. And it is, it's kind of a yogurt-thick substance that you can use, and it's very flexible. You can see it here on the frame of the mirror. You can take very good details, and you can make it just like MDF, but you can pour it into a very soft soft form, and it's really rigid. You can also use it for outside use, so only made for leftovers materials. This is a pavilion of 3XN. It's an architectural office. They wanted to make this totally out of bio-based composites. And this is what the yachting industry is busy with very, very much. How can we use not only glass, but also natural fibers? How can we use not polyester, but bio-based resins? And this pavilion, what they wanted to use is only bio-based materials, but also use smart coatings and smart materials like piezoelectric cells that generate the energy from the children that jumping up and down, so it can give light, generate light. It has a self-cleaning coating of it, on it. And they went to the GEC in Paris, the GEC, it's a big composite fair in Paris, and they were looking for all kind of natural fibers. I think that hemp is the best fiber till now. And they made, instead of the glass fiber, they used cork mats to make this layer and to reinforce the structure. They used hemp textiles. And It looks a little bit like a boat, actually. So the whole construction is made of bio-based materials. Of course, it's not floating in the sea, so it's just something different. Another material is Pure. It's a material that is very flexible and it can have a lot of impact. So it's a polypropylene composite, which is recyclable instead of the GRPs that we are using now. So it's very lightweight, and you can use it for helmets, or you can use it for here the Tumi uses in suitcases. So you can throw with it, and it just absorbs the impact of it. Another technique which could also be interesting for other industries is the FIDO technique. It's actually blowing up or pumping up a metal structure like the tires of your bicycle. Oskar Cheta is doing this, and he's making very lightweight but very rigid structures with it. And actually, this is how it's done. You just seal two metal plates, and just like a tire, you pump it up. So you're pushing air into the void. And so you are able to make all kinds of structures, not only chairs and tables, but also bridges. So you can make flexible bridges, or perhaps for yachting industry, like the stairs to climb into on the boat and outside in the water again. 3D printing, of course, all these digital manufacturing techniques are really popular, and a lot is going on. You can 3D print about everything nowadays. So at the end of January, we'll have material experience in Rotterdam, and we have three teams. It's one theme is the new technique. So all the digital manufacturing techniques, like using robots and 3D printing, are then discussed also with the speakers in the seminar. And now we are collecting a lot of materials, which materials can be 3D printed. You can 3D print, of course, all the PLAs and the plastics, but also wood, metal, glass, meat, the strangest thing you can 3D print, chocolate and sugar, of course. So it is really interesting to see, okay, how is this technique evolving, and what can we do with it? How can we use it? These chairs have been printed by Freedom of Creation for a yacht. Costs are €20,000 a piece. They want to have three chairs. And this is really interesting, but of course, 3D printing in this size is quite expensive, and it's for especially unique things, but the yachting industry, where there's all about luxurious stuff, this can be a really interesting client, of course, and to showcase that. This is a chair of Lilian van Daal. It's also 3D printed. It's from a very hot plastic, but the configuration is very soft, so you can press it. And she did it because the couches and the chairs gives a lot of rubbish and a lot of waste, so that cannot be recycled. So she said, okay, I want to have all the features of the couch in one 3D printed element. So one material has to do the trick of everything. So it has to be flexible, it has to have the structure, it has to be soft, it has to be nice appealing. So this is, it's quite fragile, but this is a new way of thinking how you can use 3D printing in regular products. 3D printing of structures in the building industry. This is made of concrete. There's a lot of research in using, actually it's not that difficult, but if you are able to make concrete structures without the cost of the labor, then it could be a really interesting idea. And of course, 3D printing is making it available that we can make totally different forms, which we were not able to make in the past because we didn't have this tool. For instance, airplane, 3D printed airplane, 3D printed boat. It's a very small one, but we can make also, of course, the parts of it. This is in the yacht design of Zaha Hadid, so totally different kind of view of how we can make yachts. I don't know how they are going to make this, but you could make it in a 3D printing technique. It's a canoe that's made by a designer, which is just his home, it's his Ultimaker, just with his home print, because he was printing the kind of a Lego blocks. So he was designing the blocks, the connections, and then he can put, this is a little bit what Joris van der Laar is doing with his chair, that everybody can print a little piece and then you connect these pieces together and you have the chair. This guy is doing this with pieces and to connect them like Lego and you have a canoe. So it's a fantastic idea that you just can make your own canoe with your ultimate printer and a lot of resin, of course. And the contrary is that this is a very stupid, of course, it's Chinese. The Chinese are copying, of course, all the 3D printing techniques and all our innovations too. But you can see here that something's going wrong, because what I just told, that the technique is enabling us to make different forms. You can see here a regular form, which is just used when you're using brick. And so I would like to challenge everybody who's busy with the 3D printer to use the technique for a new kind of aesthetic, a new kind of forms. For instance, this is a part of the technique which is used for the facade in one of the kennel house. Nowadays there's a kennel house in Amsterdam where the facade is totally 3D printed. Another 3D printed boat done by students. Very proud of it. Again, very small. Robots, robotizing, also a digital manufacturing technique. Very interesting, because this is actually from RoboFold. It's a London-based manufacturer who's able to fold like origami, how we are using paper and origami. He is doing this with robots. So the robots are folding the metal. So Zaha Hadid is working with this guy a lot to make these very strange forms, very beautiful forms. And it's not only aesthetic, it's also making the structure. So this is how it works. Two robots just bending, totally digital, the form. So you can make the forms which are structural need. Lucon is a veneer. It's a luxurious kind of, it's not a veneer, it's translucent concrete, but they are able to make veneer. So the same way as they made this translucent wood, it used to start with translucent concrete, because you make it like a lasagna. You make concrete and cement, and then you have a layer of glass fibers and another layer of concrete. And of course, then you build up this translucent concrete. But they are also possible to make veneer. So they cut a very thin layer, flexible concrete, imagine that, which is also transparent. So it's a fantastic combination of material properties in one very thin veneer. And of course, then you can use it in a yard where everything should be lightweight, because concrete in a yard is a stupid idea, unless it's veneer. So then you can have this. This is a bit a strange example. When you talk about luxurious materials or the value of materials in general, what is the value? Of course, the economic value, it's scarce, it's not there. Gold, it is limited, so that then it's very expensive. It can be expensive because it's handmade and it took a lot of work and a lot of time to make it. But it can also be the story behind it. And that's really interesting, to have story behind a material. And this is a very strange story. We see Onassis. The yacht is the Christina O. It was the yacht of Onassis, named to his daughter. And there was a bar in this yacht. And the stools, the crux, the chairs of this bar were covered with leather. You say, okay, this is normal leather. And of course, he was very fond of women, and he invited all the women. And then he said, okay, this leather is made of the foreskin of a whale. So this makes the totally different. So that makes the value of this stool, this chair, totally different, because it's a very exclusive kind of leather. It's just a leftover. We don't have it in our collection because the whale is a protected fish. But or it's not a fish, it's an animal, a zoogdier. And Schulirecht is an Iceland-based designer who is, of course, the whales come in there, with the fishers are there taking the whales, and he is using this leather for making shoes and wallets. So it's very expensive. You don't see, look at it, you don't see it, but of course, if you tell it, okay, these shoes are made of this kind of leather, totally different value. So this is really interesting to discuss, okay, what's the value of a material? There's also other kind of leathers. We have here a very nice red leather, which is very embossed by Futuro Leathers. We have also the leather of a stomach, because the leftovers of all the animal stomachs and bull's balls, also leftovers from the meat industry, you can make leather out of that. So that's also not only from plants, there are bio-based leftovers, but also from the animal industry. This is a veneer made of natural stone, like slate. So you can take, if you have a slate block and you put a resin on it, and then like you're horsing or epilating your legs, and you put this stuff out of the slate, you can have a very thin, flexible, translucent veneer of natural stone. And you can cover books, you can with it, you can make shoes of it, but you can clad it on round surfaces, so it's really interesting. Thorn D is, for the yachting industry, a very new material, like an anti-fouling carpet. So instead of just every year painting the bottom of your or the below of your yacht or your ship, if you put this material on it, it's a very thin carpet, then you can see it on the right, all the organisms have no grip on it. They are not attached to this ship. It's especially for very big ships, because it's quite expensive, but then you don't have to coat your yacht anymore, or everything that's in the water, again, as anti-fouling. Another interesting development in the material world is the smart materials. Smart, really smart materials are materials that have a brain and an acceptor and a reactor. Like my glasses are thermo or photochromic. So if I go outside, it reacts on a UV radiation and it becomes a sunglass. You have those materials that react on the temperature differences and change of color. You have the piezoelectric cells, which, if they are pressed, that they generate energy. You have thermoelectric materials. If you put this cell in your boot when you are hiking in the snow, outside it's cold, your boot and inside it's warm. So the difference of temperature generates energy too. So you can just walking on the mountain and you can recharge your smartphone by the energy that you are making from the difference of temperature. Materials then can become rigid when you hit on it. Materials that can grow when the pressure is on it. So all these materials, it's really interesting to discover that, can be used also in yachting industry. It can also make an anti-fouling material, antibacterial coating. So just try to do a lot of research in this, because I think it's really the material property and materials of the future. If we really use these small materials on an intelligent way in our future designs, it can solve a lot of problems. Well, the best way, of course, to connect or to have a connection between the normal architecture and the sailing industry are houseboats or water villas. There is a huge research going on. The old houseboats, I live in a houseboat in the neighborhood of Lunen. It's very interesting because it only has 10,000 spots in Netherlands that can, where you can have this houseboat. There are not coming any spots more. So this is a very, very scarce spot, so they are very expensive to have, but they can have, while actually normally houseboats were for the poor people that could not afford a house, and now it's switched over. But they are making floating cities, they are making floating houses, and this is in Eiburg, it's a totally floating neighborhood, and you can see it's are two houses in one. And the last year we had a lecture of the developer of this area, and he said it was very, very difficult because in general the city organization and all the governmental organizations said, okay, what is it? Is it the house or is it the boat? How do we do with fire things, and how do we do with the garbage and the electricity, and what kind of organizations should be connected? Well, what is it? So it took a lot of work and talking with a lot of parties to make and realize this project. The fun thing is that it's not a standalone house. You have a neighbor. So if your neighbor is buying a piano and is putting it in his house, then the whole construction is crooked. So you have to have a good relation with your neighbor when you live in this. But Of course, the fantastic thing is that it's made in a big hall, like a yacht, like a ship. So you can just do anything on time. No budgets that have to be raised because you are fixed. You have no problems with the weather and the rain and other costs. You just make it in a big hall and you just transport your house to the spot there where it is. So it's a very, very good way of industrializing and your house and your building industry. And you just connect it with a lot of streets, floating streets, and you have a beautiful, fantastic, movable, floating city. So perhaps this can be also the future. So I would like to thank you.